first day I ever arrived. I walked into the door, and on the floor there was this blanket, and it was covered with babies, 11 squirmy little bodies all over this floor.
Dwarf Hope is an orphanage for abandoned babies here in South Africa, around the Johannesburg area.
There is a church where there's a hole in the wall and there's a door. So if a mother who cannot take care of her baby or doesn't want her baby, she knows she can go to this church and place her child in this bin, in this hole in the wall, and know that he's going to have a brighter future.
And then a sensor will go off and the workers will come pick up the baby and care for it. It's a service, truly doing what God calls us to do. He says to help the poor. He says to help those that can't help themselves. He says to make others happy, to glorify his name. And Dwarf Hope does all that. It takes a baby who's completely helpless and gives it a new life that it would have never had otherwise. And then with the Dwarf Hope putting the baby into an adoption process, it makes another family happy. It provides a child for a family that maybe wouldn't have one otherwise.
God has given me a passion for children. And so at the Dwarf Hope, I'm really God's hands and feet. I'm the face of Jesus to these little abandoned babies. You see just how faithful God has been to their little lives, that instead of dying in the street, you know, their mother chose life for them, or they were found by someone and they were given a second chance. And so just being there and loving on them and showing them, yes, you have a hope and a future, I think that's just so incredibly heartwarming for these children to know, and so incredibly important for them to know.
When they find out what their life was like when they were little, they're gonna be like, wow, there were so many aunties, so many volunteers that cared enough about me to raise me. And so I just feel like the love and affection that I'm able to show to these babies and providing their physical needs too, it really does make a difference to them.
The Bible says that we are to take care of orphans and widows in their distress. And it's very important that we take care of these children, because that's what Jesus commands us to do. He wants us to give these children a new hope and a new future. Because he loves the children, and he doesn't want them to be abandoned or to be lost. But he always seeks and saves us.
Jesus traveled with his disciples to Jerusalem. As he came to the Mount of Olives outside the village called Bethany, he sent two disciples ahead of him. As you enter the village, Jesus said, you will find a young donkey tied there. No one has ever ridden it. Untie it and bring it to me. If anyone asks what you're doing, say, the Lord needs it. But get this, the disciples found the donkey just like Jesus said, and when the owners asked why they were untying it, a reasonable question, I think, the disciples explained, the Lord needs it. And just like Jesus said, the owner of the donkey was totally cool with it. So they led the donkey to Jesus. They threw their robes on his back and helped Jesus get on. In the Old Testament times, a prophet had written, "Don't be afraid, your king is coming," sitting on a donkey's colt. And that prophecy came true as the donkey carried Jesus towards Jerusalem. People took palm branches and went out to meet Jesus. They spread their robes on the road where he was riding and shouted, "Hosanna, save us!" The people praised God for all the miracles Jesus had done and loudly said, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven, glory in the highest heaven." But some of the Pharisees, the religious leaders, in the crowd were upset by what was happening. They told Jesus to tell his disciples to stop shouting. I guess they were, like, super jealous. But Jesus told the Pharisees, even if the people were silent, the stones would cry out. Jesus' disciples didn't understand what was happening at first. Later, after Jesus rose from the dead, they remembered and understood what had happened on that day.
And now, a special report from Hunt Burkleton.
Followers of Jesus. Who are they? What do they do? Where do they learn it? And can they communicate with dolphins? I'm guessing no to that last one, because dolphins are a made-up animal.
They're totally real.
I'm investigative reporter Hunt Burkleton, and this is Hunt Burkleton Knows What's Really Going On with Followers of Jesus. We know that being a follower of Jesus means getting to know Jesus and his plans through prayer and reading the Bible. But what else can his followers do?
Ooh, I know the answer to this one.
Oh, really? Do tell.
No comment.
Here's something his followers can do. Stop sending me invitations to church that are filled with glitter.
I made the invitation myself and filled it with glitter.
I like glitter.
Glitter? This news hound can't help but wonder if glitter has something to do with following Jesus. Maybe his followers just really like to make sparkly crafts?
If they do, it's not until they're done doing unicycle stunts.
You don't have to like glitter and do stunts or whatever to follow Jesus.
As a follower of Jesus, I can tell you what's important is to praise Jesus. Praising Jesus means you give him glory.
And of course, glory means to glue something to someone named Lori.
Not even close.
We give Jesus glory by loving him. We can do that by singing, or writing poems, or stories, or by telling other people how good he is.
You could use your art, including glitter.
Or your excellent fashion sense.
Or by doing awesome stunts.
It sounds like there are endless ways to praise Jesus.
Praise is a way to share how great Jesus is. You can use your talents, your money, your personality, whatever.
And there you have it. Praise, a major part of what it means to be a follower of Jesus. Join me next time as we ask the question, if Jesus died, can he still be alive?
Absolutely.
The answer may surprise you.
No, it won't. I just said it.
Until then, I'm investigative reporter Hunt Burkleton, and this is Hunt Burkleton Knows What's Really Going On.
We have so many reasons to praise God. We can praise him for the ways he cares for us, the things he teaches us, and how he loves us. Best of all, we can praise God for Jesus, the Savior and the Messiah. Let's talk to some kids about praising God. What do you praise God for?
I praise God for all the blessings we have, especially in America, where we can have all the things that a lot of people don't have.
For my family.
I usually like nature, so I really like animals, so like all the trees and animals.
I praise God for my family and that I'm so blessed.
Why should people praise God for sending Jesus?
Because Jesus has done so many things for us, so we should do things for him by praising him.
Because he died on the cross for us and did a lot of good things just to save us.
Because it was a gift from him.
Without Jesus, we wouldn't have eternal life and we wouldn't be able to spend eternal life with God.
Some people think that praising God means singing songs to him. Singing is a great way to praise, but it isn't the only way. You can praise God by giving offerings, praying, and telling others why Jesus is so special. You also can praise by playing instruments or using other talents. The book of Psalms is full of scriptures about praising God. Psalm 65 verse 1 says that praise belongs to God. Psalm 92 verse 1 tells us that it is good to give thanks to God and praise him. Psalm 135 praises God because he is good. And Psalm 150 says that all living things should praise God. We have a lot of reasons to praise God. One of the greatest reasons is because God sent His Son, Jesus. Old Testament prophets told of a coming Messiah who would be the Savior. The Messiah and Savior is Jesus. Jesus died on the cross and was raised back to life to provide salvation and eternal life for everyone who believes in Him. Have you praised God lately? Make a list of all the amazing things you know about God. Read aloud verses from the book of Psalms, give an offering, or tell someone what you know about Jesus. Praise God and thank Him for sending Jesus.
Jesus sent his son, so those who believe could become his own. That's all love does. He sent his son.